Today, I'm going to take a closer look at this vintage Weston galvanometer that my buddy, another maker, sent a while ago. He picked this up, he tells me, at a flea market down in Florida for, well, this and one other thing bundled together for 10 bucks, which is pretty impressive. I wish I lived close to flea markets like that. Anyway, this galvanometer, oh, first of all, I guess a galvanometer is an early type of ammeter, a very sensitive micro ammeter. And actually, galvanometer refers mostly or partly to the mechanism of the mechanical meter itself, which is the same as the mechanical display parts of any analog type meter that you would care to mention or you've ever encountered. The galvanometer, or, oh, I'm going to butcher this spelling, this pronunciation, I know I am. So the name of that type of movement is the Arsenovo/Weston. I think, I don't know. If you've been paying attention, you know that my French pronunciation is worse than horrible, but there it is. You can pronounce it for yourself. Anyway, the basics of the meter are exactly the same as it was back then. You have two permanent magnets along either side here, a north and a south, and then a coil of wire wrapped around this center form, which is on a really low friction bearing and mechanically attached to the pointer. And when you run a current, an electrical current, through that coil of wire, it is going to, the magnetic field generated is going to act on the magnetic field of these two permanent magnets and create some movement or deflection. That's how all of these mechanical analog meter movements work. There's another slightly more detailed look at it. And these springs coming in are mostly the conductor, but the magnetic field sort of acts against those springs as well to help calibrate it. And there's also one other bit. There's a mechanical zeroing, more than a calibration, that allows you to, when there's no current, to adjust the needle to rest at the actual zero position. I'll link you to this Wikipedia article so that you can read a lot more about how the thing works internally, but that's the basics. They are generally listed or rated at their full scale current. For instance, in this case, they're talking about one that at 100 microamps, it indicates a full scale deflection. So that will allow you to calibrate the dial and calculate what the exact current that you're measuring is. In most cases, this type of meter will actually be measuring, getting its input measured across a shunt resistor, that being a really low resistance calibrated resistor that is in series with the current path. So the actual current path that you're measuring isn't going through here. And what you're measuring is going to be just a fraction, a calculated fraction of the actual current. But with some math and a calibration chart, you can get the direct relationship between the meter deflection and the actual current being measured. Now, and to the best of my knowledge, this guy does not have a current shunt in it, so you're measuring straight through there. I suspect that these old guys would have been sold with or provided with or have available external calibrated current shunts so that you could measure larger currents. And that's what this one is or was. This is out of an old AM radio transmitter, and it can read up to 20 amps, but obviously you're not going to put 20 amps through that meter movement. It measured across a shunt, which used to be connected there before this one got decommissioned. And that's also how even the most modern of and most cheap meters measure current. That right there is the shunt. That is the DC current or AC current input measured across ground, and it go, and then we are measuring the current flow through that, or measuring the voltage across it. This is a known resistance. And using Ohm's law, you can figure out the actual current from the voltage measured across there and the resistance that you're measuring across. So as I mentioned when we were looking at the Wikipedia article, there is the mechanical zeroing, which is what this screw is right here. And that just lets you adjust the whole mechanism, rotate it around inside to get the needle lined up with the zero on the scale. Let's go carefully and slowly, and there we go. So now, assuming that it is still in calibration, hasn't been damaged, now we're starting from zero and we can go to full scale. Full scale on this one is 60, but notice it doesn't say amps or anything in there. Down in the bottom, it says one division equals 2.2 times 10 to the minus 6 amps. One division is one little tick in there. So full scale is going to be 60 times 2.2 to the times 10 to the minus 6, which is 132 microamps equals the 60 divisions full scale. So with a little bit of math, you can create a calibration chart so you can tell exactly what you're reading directly. Now again, I suspect that this guy was not being used directly most of the time. It was probably being used with a current shunt so that it could read larger currents, more useful currents, and a wider variety of currents. But each shunt would come with a calibration chart similar to that, only probably as a graph, actually, I would suspect. I think I'm going to hook this guy up and just try and see how close to calibrated it is. And since I got this little calibration reference in the last mailbag, which has a known 179.99 kiloohm resistor in it, I'm going to do a little bit of math and put some voltage through here and just see how close it is. Okay, so here is the moderately janky test setup. Yes, there is going to be a little bit of resistance in these wires. Yes, this may not be precise voltage, but it's pretty damn close. We know the resistance there. I'm not going for multi-position precision here. I'm just checking to see how close this thing is, if it's in the ballpark. So with 5 volts there, 179.99 kOhms there, we should get about 2 microamps, is that correct? 27 microamps, which according to this will be just over the 10 scale on the reading. Let's find out. Bouncy, bouncy. Settles in just a hair under 10. It should be a bit over, but that's not too bad. Crank this voltage up here. So there we're showing mid scale 30 on there, which should be 66 microamps. And over here we are showing 15.12 volts. And that calculates out as 84 microamps, if that was accurate. And for 30 for mid scale, we had figured 66. So it's a little bit off, but I mean, what do you want for a meter from 1926-ish? That's another thing. It's a late 1920s design, so it's been around for a while, and I bet it hasn't been treated gently over its life. Anyways, we know it works. It's not 100% precise, but so be it. Let's take a look inside here and see what we can find in the box, shall we? Don't worry, I'll be gentle. That's not a museum piece, but it is now part of my museum, so I don't want to destroy it. Yeah, pretty clear that this isn't an original box. This is just some masonite and some wood that's been painted green. This part here, I don't think is original either. The original parts are these and this bezel here. But I think I'm just going to take apart the carpentry and see what I can find in there. One moment, please. Not too much going on in there. Actually, that piece there does look like it may have been original. with some slight modifications maybe. I don't know what these holes here that have been filled in are or were. Anyway, the meter body itself is a fully enclosed piece. Looks like to get into it, you'd take off those four screws. This push button just adds a, what is that? 20K 0.5% precision resistor. Okay. So that resistor is in series with the positive input until you push that push button, which bypasses it. So the readings that I was taking earlier had that 20K extra in series with it. So I'm going to risk going one layer deeper into this thing. Now, the potential for disaster is the mechanical linkage between that adjuster screw and the needle, and between this knob and... Oh, right, I didn't mention that before. This knob here controls just a fixed pointer that you can put wherever so that you've got something to compare against. Basically, it's a limit line that you can see mechanically. It doesn't interact with the other needle. It's just a visual indicator. But its linkage and the needle's linkage may get buggered up when I lift this out, and I hope it doesn't. Okay, so that needle, or the limit needle, is permanently up there. There is the back of the zero adjustment screw. It's got that little offset peg, and it goes down into this little fork right here. So when I'm putting it back on, I can kind of slide it in and get it on there. But you can see in here, very much like the diagram on Wikipedia. Hang on, let me just turn this around here. Okay, as I was saying, very much like the diagram on Wikipedia. There is one of the permanent magnets. There is the other one. Here is our needle with a little counterweight on the back of it. You see just down there? Being held in a bearing in there. And when you adjust this, it just moves the whole mechanism. Now, without the metal of the front on here, we've changed the magnetic characteristics ever so slightly, which is why that's off. And it's not being shielded as much anymore. So any stray magnetism in the room is just buggering with it completely. And you can see the mechanical stops there and there so that the needle doesn't go right out of the window. It'll go a little bit negative and a little bit beyond the top of the range. But those are just little bits of wire with, looks like wire insulation or rubber or something on there. Yeah, any little bit of static electricity in the air, including off my little PLA plastic pointer here, is impacting that. And it's crazy sensitive, probably even my breath. So here is one of the electrical connections coming in, and it just follows this little wire onto there. And on the back side, there will be the other one coming from there. There you can see the magnetic coil wrapped around this core. When I move the needle, you'll see it move there. I think you can just see that coiled spring there. I can't point at it because I'm holding the flashlight with my other hand here. But that is providing the force to resist the magnet. And that delicate balance of mechanical and electrical and magnetic is what causes this thing to do its magic. Ah, there's something else I didn't point out earlier. See this here? This is a little mirrored piece. If you look straight down on the needle, and I can't get it with the camera properly here. I'm trying to get this to work, but I just can't. Anyway, in natural lighting and not looking through a camera, basically you look straight down at that so that the reflection of the needle in that mirror and the actual needle are perfectly lined up straight. That is to eliminate a thing called parallax error, to make sure that when you're reading the scale, you're not looking at an angle. Where is something here? So there is some distance between the needle and the scale behind it. And depending on the angle that you're looking at, that distance can create some error. I am holding that straight above the 9, but if you're looking at it from a wonky angle, it looks like it's at a different position. So that's what that mirror behind there is for, to force you to look straight down on the needle And if the needle and its reflection are lined up, then from that viewing angle, the needle is also straight above the point that you're actually trying to read on the scale. People who are only used to digital meters may never have encountered that, so figured I'd point that out. Anyway, before I put this guy back together, I'm just going to get some glass cleaner, clean that little lens up, and put it all back together. Okay, now that it's back together and the glass is cleaned, I've reestablished my little test rig here. I'll turn that on again. Let the meter settle out. It should settle it right in near that 30 if it's repeatable, if we didn't knock it out of alignment. Okay, so now then we'll take that resistor out of the circuit. So this is measuring just this 180k minus a couple of ohms. I'm going to bring my voltage down until we hit right on the 30. I'm shifting my head around to take care of that parallax error there, which you can't unfortunately see through the camera. But there we are, bang on the 30. And without that, it drops down to 27. That gives us 13.62 volts. That's 75 microamps for, which is pretty much what we calculated before. Yeah, so that's still a little bit off, but pretty good for something that's many decades older than I am. Hell, I'm not even that accurate now at my age. Do we want to tear into this thing? This one is, as I mentioned, it's out of an AM radio transmitter. It's designed for measuring radio frequency, but again, it's just measuring a voltage drop over a resistor as current through this meter. So the mechanism should be almost identical to that, just a little bit more compact. Yeah, let's do that. So first we can still see that little zeroing screw there, exactly the same. There's the zeroing mechanism. There's the counterweight on the back of the needle. You just barely see the two magnets down in there. And okay, we'll slide the scale up out of the way. By the way, Box Simpson Limited, London, Canada. So you can see where the shunt used to be. And there's a series resistor and the wire going to the other end that would have come off the sampling points of that. You can sort of see sitting vertically there, there's the coil of wire. See it down here when I pull this guy out of the way. Clamshell magnets are, one is up there and one is down there. If you look down in here, you can just sort of see the gap between them. So that's essentially the same mechanism decades later. Anyway, I hope you found that somewhat interesting. Thanks so much for another maker finding this and thinking of me and sending it to me. I think he actually paid more in postage to get it to me than he did for the actual item. Buddy, I appreciate that. Thank you. That will get a little bit more polishing up and end up in pride of place on a shelf somewhere in my shop here. For everybody else, thank you so much for watching. Comments and questions down below as usual. Yeah, I will talk to you later.